عبد الله. وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وصحبه الأخيار المنتجبين وعلى جميع الأنبياء والمرسلين من يوم آدم إلى قيام يوم الدين. In the name of Allah, the most compassionate, more compassionate than any human can possibly be. And the most merciful, more merciful, by far more merciful than any human can possibly be. The reason why I'm beginning in this way, because after touching last night on one single point, one specific point, I want to expand on it a little, which is the character of Al-Imam Al-Hussein, peace be upon him, being compassionate that he only shed his tears feeling sorry for all of those people who will go to hellfire for killing him. We mentioned the story last night when Al-Imam Al-Hussein, peace be upon him, on his way to Al-Kufa, he was asking his companions to always get some water supplies. And when Al-Hur ibn Yazid al-Riyahi, the chief of command or the army commander of the enemy, he and his troops became thirsty. Al-Imam al-Hussein, peace be upon him, told his companions to actually give water for the enemies. And this was Al-Imam al-Hussein. This is how compassionate he was. The reason why we need to emphasize this point is that Ashura or Karbala is not a battle. It's not just a battle. It is the battle of the battles. It's the battle of humanity in every single aspect, even when it comes to love and compassion. Even when it comes to love and compassion. Al-Imam al-Hussein, peace be upon him, says, if somebody was to curse me in the right ear and then apologize in the left, I will forgive him. I will forgive him. And that, of course, comes from Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and we'll come back to a few hadith in this regard. The thing is, the forgiveness and love of Al-Imam al-Hussein enabled him to stand facing all of these people repeatedly to warn them of what's awaiting them, hellfire that's awaiting them if they kill him. It's not for himself. He had already said, by Allah, I don't see death except happiness of living amongst the oppressors, but headache. So it wasn't for him, it was for their sake. And he was able to stand facing them and remind them of the Prophet, what he had said, pretty much tell them some words of wisdom, hoping that they will wake up before it's too late. So many of us know that Al-Hur ibn Yazid al-Riyahi at the end, when the battle was just about to happen, he was seen by somebody and this person asked Al-Hur, what are you doing? He said, I am giving myself two choices between hellfire and paradise, and by Allah, wallah, I do not choose anything over paradise. And he went to Al-Imam al-Hussein, peace be upon him, apologized, and requested forgiveness. Al-Imam al-Hussein, of course, forgave him and told him, free you lived and free you shall die. Because it was obviously a battle. It was a losing battle in the physical means. Everybody knew they were going to get killed. No question about it. So, this reminds us, this is a little off the subject, but Rasulullah, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, saying that you as people, your price is paradise. Never sell yourself for anything that's less. Which is very meaningful. So, to expand on this a little, subject of mercy and forgiveness and such, from Ashura, there's some really beautiful words when Al-Imam Ali, peace be upon him, writes to Malik al-Ashtar after appointing him as a ruler on Egypt. In this letter, Al-Imam Ali, peace be upon him, says to Malik, "Oh Malik, people are two kinds. The first are people who are brothers and sisters for you in Islam, while the others are people who are like you in humanity, or brothers and sisters in humanity. Show your mercy to these people on earth as you would like Allah Azza wa Jal to show you His mercy on Judgment Day." See how meaningful this is. This is very profound. Because, in other words, Al-Imam Ali, peace be upon him here, and of course, what Al-Imam al-Husayn has done is stating that if you would like Allah Azza wa Jal to be merciful unto you on Judgment Day, you have to show your mercy and forgiveness to people here on earth. Because as we all know, he who does not thank his servant does not praise the Lord. And likewise, if you cannot show your mercy to people here on earth, why would you expect Allah Azza wa Jal to be merciful unto you on Judgment Day? So, just a quick verse from Surah Fussilat. وَلَا تَسْتَوِي الْحَسَنَةُ وَلَا السَّيِّئَةُ. Goodness and evil are not equal. Rebel evil with what's better. اتفع بالتي هي أحسن. Then he between you and he was animosity will be a friend and intimate. فإذا الذي بينك وبينه عداوة كأنه ولي حميم. From this we can see mercy and forgiveness and love in Islam. And again, those are of course and absolutely shown by the actions of Al-Imam al-Husayn, peace be upon him, when he gave water to the enemy, while the enemy did not give him water when, you know, they banned them from water, on the contrary. And when Al-Imam al-Husayn, peace be upon him, forgave Al-Hur ibn Yazid al-Riyahi, when he says that if my enemy or if somebody was to curse me with my right ear and accept requests forgiveness in the left, I will forgive him. And of course, that's a point that I should mention, that throughout the way to Al-Kufa, Al-Imam al-Husayn, peace be upon him, was actually trying to talk to people who did not come on his way, did not come with him, that they can join his, you know, his group and his company. Not because he wanted this one person. He did not send his messenger, or according to some other stories, he went himself to Zuhayr ibn al-Qayn, that he would have one extra soldier or one extra, you know, supporter. Well, what does it matter? I mean, when it comes to real battle, if you have 1, 5, 10 more people, it's not going to make a difference. But he knew what Zuhayr ibn al-Qayn was, and he knew that if Zuhayr ibn al-Qayn would not support him, he will go to hell. Because people who see the truth, people who see what's going on, and they do not support Al-Imam al-Husayn, there is no question about it. People, whoever of you sees an evil tyrant who is legalizing what Allah has forbids what Allah has legalized, and violates the tradition of the Prophet's household and oppresses the worshippers of Allah and does not condemn his deed and word or act, Allah would treat him in the same manner on Judgment Day. Likewise, Al-Imam al-Husayn, peace be upon him, because this was his responsibility, but he also knew that people who do not support him and his mission will go to hell. And so he sent a messenger, according to some stories, according to some others, he went himself to Zuhayr ibn al-Qayn, and he talked to him. And of course, Zuhayr ibn al-Qayn changed and ended up joining the Imam's company where he actually fell a murderer. So we can, from this we can see that Al-Imam Al-Husayn, peace be upon him, his compassion was so grand that even when these people were plotting to kill him, he did not want them to go to him. That's how forgiving he was. That's how compassionate he was. And another verse of the Holy Quran, when it says that we made you people and tribes in order that you know each other, not in order that you despise each other. Inna akramakum 'inda Allahi atqakum. Meaning that Allah has created us from various people and tribes. And of, you know, dhakar wa untha, we male and female, and people and tribes in order that you know each other, not in order that you despise each other. So the Holy Quran emphasizes compassion and love amongst mankind, amongst us as a human beings. And Al-Imam Al-Husayn, peace be upon him, in every single aspect of Ashura, we can see how he loves. We can see his compassion. Another point that we must mention here, when we speak of forgiveness and compassion, we must do touch upon anger. And I touch upon it because I know this is a very big issue that we have in our communities. We always hear about it. Al-Imam Al-Husayn obviously did not lose his temper. Did he ever lose his temper? They killed Muslim al-Aqib. Did he lose his temper? No. On the contrary, he prayed for these people. He still was trying to convince them to return to the right path. From this we can see that anger is very bad. To act hastily, and he would be defeating the Satan or devil of his insulter, and of course defeating his insulter, because there's nothing that defeats the enemy more so than overlooking or disregarding that insult, their insults, as if they do not exist. Kinda they start to feel that their trees are not bearing fruits. You know, you're trying to bully someone or you're trying to attack somebody to show off or get something back in a way or another, show that, you know, you can do it. When people ignore you, first of all, the devil cannot escalate the problem. And second, of course, he would feel that he got defeated because he did not return his insult. I'm out of time, I see that. So we will hopefully, God, inshallah, God willing, finish the subject tomorrow and touch upon a couple other points which are perhaps just as important, the role of Sayyidah Zainab, peace be upon her. Astaghfirullah li wa lakum, Allahumma kulli waliyyika al-hujjat ibn al-Hasan, salawatuka alayhi wa ala abaih, fi hadihi al-sa'a wa fi kulli sa'a, waliyan wa hafidhan wa qaidan wa nasira, wa daleelan wa ayna, hatta tuskinahu ardaka taw'a wa tumatta'ahu fiha taweela. اللهم اجعلنا من أنصاره وأعوانه وأتباعه وشيعته والمستشارين في أمره. السلام عليك يا سيدي مولاي يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك. عليكم مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيته بقي الليل والنهار، ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين ورحمة الله وبركاته. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. الله وأجر أولاده.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
انتبه فشخ فشخ.
طيب الله أنفاسكم حاج محمد، شكرا جزيلا. أجركم الله جميعا، عظم الله أجوركم. يقول الله